You here. We welcome those of us who have joined us on live stream also. Actually, the text we're going to cover tonight, I covered last time. I didn't intentionally mean to cover it again, but there were some fresh thoughts I had about it, so now I know why.
Amen.
John 6, 11 through 13. I think this is actually the 74th. Listen. This is how the text reads. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise to the fishes as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. Now it's interesting to observe that there's no record of a person or a group coming to Jesus for him to feed them. Interesting.
Yeah.
Even though there's 2 examples, this is the first of him feeding a multitude. Miraculously, there's no record of anyone asking him to do so. This is particularly arresting when you consider that a lot of people came to him for healing. Whereas they didn't come to him for feeding. I do not believe there are any examples in Scripture of someone coming to Jesus to get something they could get from someone else. Now, I reserve the right to be wrong, but I don't think there is any example like that. This is the result of Christ's unique work. He did things that nobody else could do. Anybody could feed the multitude if they had the resources.
Yeah. I mean,
not anybody could heal the multitude. Jesus is associated with extraordinary things, and at the point you associate him with ordinary things, he gets further away.
Yeah.
And more difficult to perceive. You'll not be able to see. If what you want Jesus for is to get a job or resolve your marriage or something of that sort, believe me when I tell you, you will have a hard time finding him. I'm not saying he can't help you in those areas. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that's not what he came to do.
Yeah.
Right. If other people can do it, then I would think that just makes Jesus an option.
That's exactly right. Uh-huh. That's
gonna
exactly
be a primary
right.
source. Yeah.
That's right.
But see, this has virtually been hidden in our time. Anything that any person can do or any institution can do, I'm not sure it's justified to go to Jesus to do it.
Yeah.
I know this puts the marriage counselors like out of business.
Yeah.
I understand that. And this puts those that are correcting human behavior, this puts them out of business. See, I understand that. But they need to be put out of business.
Yes, amen.
Because they're a distraction. See, they're a distraction, particularly when they connect what they're doing with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. I think this could be extended
as well to the words of Jesus, the things that he said while he was here personally. He said
yes.
That when someone makes them, when people say things like, well, it's just like every other word in the Bible. See, they've lessened Jesus.
That's right. No, it's not like any other word. Yeah. a greater than Solomon is here.
Yes, amen.
That's what Jesus said. Mm-hmm. Now, where Jesus, as I said, is not associated with extraordinary things, it cannot be attained or received or realized or experienced any place else. I don't know what need there really is for Jesus.
Yeah.
The chief drawing card to Jesus that God has put in the earth is the church.
Yes. Amen.
That's the city set on a hill.
Yes.
That's the light lifted up. That's the means God uses to attract people to Christ, is his church, the body. No other institution has been charged with this responsibility. Men have created institutions, all right, that they say that they claim this is what they're doing. Mm-hmm. But they're going to have a hard time proving this, because Christ's body is the agent appointed to bring people to Christ. God, that's once Christ works through that. God works through that. I think because people won't come to Jesus unless they know they need something no one else can supply. I think this is one of the reasons why people use creative ways to get people to the church. Entertainment, music, magic, all kind of ploys to get people there, because what Jesus does isn't attractive to people that don't have an appetite for it. And that's really all the church has to offer. It doesn't mean it's not helpful. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying it's wrong to be helpful and help in emergencies. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that's not what the church is to be known for. When it's not unique, when something associated with Jesus is not unique or it blends easily with the world, it will not be used by God. It will not. God would have to compromise his nature and ignore his son to use something other than his son and his body to attract people to himself. God will not do it. So people resort to marketing, special programs, neighborhood ministries, etc., exercise programs, etc., marriage seminars, it's just an endless list. But this is not what Jesus did. Now you've got the... We don't have to guess at this. We've got a record God has given of his son. Four gospels that cover just about every facet of Christ's ministry. So we've got plenty of examples of what Jesus did. And he never resorted to anything like that. In fact, he didn't feed people to get them to come.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
He only fed them after they came and stayed all day.
Yeah,
3 days.
Yeah. 3 days, yeah, that was the fourth. That was the 3 days.
All our food was gone.
Yeah.
So that's when he fed them. See, the world feeds them and then says, now we'll preach to them. That's I don't know who started that, but we need to find out and tell them to go back get an honest job somewhere, because that's not how Jesus did it.
And he wouldn't even feed them when he knew they came for the
that's
food.
Right. So as with that in mind, we'll look at this text. Jesus nor God will use to implement their purpose something God has classified as foolishness. God says the wisdom of the world is foolishness. So he's not going to use that to attract people to Jesus or make a name for Jesus or reach the hearts of people. I'm sorry, but not really so sorry. He is not going to use that. Now, I first want to address, I'm going to address this text a little different than I did before. This is under the heading, Who does Jesus feed? Now let's establish first of all that Jesus is a feeder.
Yeah.
He is a feeder. He provides nourishment for the soul. Isaiah said of him, he shall feed his flock like a shepherd. See, that's what he does. He shall gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those that are with young. Again, Isaiah says, they shall not hunger nor thirst, neither shall the heat or sun smite them, for he that hath mercy on them shall lead them, even by springs of water shall he guide them. See? So Jesus is a feeder. He will not guide people without feeding people. He won't answer questions without increasing their understanding. See, as people come to Jesus, they had questions. Should we pay tribute to Caesar? You know? Is it lawful to pay tribute to Caesar? They had questions. How about speaking to my brother? He divide the inheritance. See, Jesus, he didn't cater to those kind of things. He did not. He's the feeder. And he feeds a total flock. He doesn't feed like this a certain segment of the flock. He feeds the whole flock. He nourishes them and keeps them strong. The purpose of feeding, keep them strong and able to navigate. So let's see, who does he feed? He feeds those who come to him.
Yes.
Not those that ought to come to him, those who come to him. The people before Jesus came to him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Matthew said of this group, they followed him on foot out of all the cities. They came to him. Mark says, and the people saw them departing, and they knew him, and ran afoot thither out of all the cities, and out went them, and came together unto him. See, they came to him. I'm sure, who does Jesus feed? People come to him.
Yeah.
Luke says, and the people, when they knew it, followed him, and he received them, and spake unto them of the kingdom of God, and healed them that had need of healing. John says, when Jesus then lifted up his eyes and saw a great multitude, a great company, come unto him. See, so he feeds those that come to him.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Amen.
We should not expect Jesus to feed people that don't come to him.
Yeah, that's
right. Amen.
Uh-huh. See, when you go and preach the gospel, you've got to discern who the comers are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of attention paid to it. I know by experience. See, I was raised up in the system. Mm-hmm. And I know that there was nothing hardly ever said about this, about detecting who the comers are. Yeah. Who are the interested ones? So they had all kind of things to get people interested.
Uh-huh.
But if they're not interested already, I actually believe that the Holy Spirit will say, don't go there. Don't go into Asia. Don't go into Bithynia. There's some comers over there in Macedonia.
Yeah.
See?
I was kind of thinking along these lines today. I was thinking about how it's a sad situation sometimes whenever you want to speak the truth, like you want to speak something that you know that's the truth, mm-hmm. but you know it's not going to be received.
That's right.
Yeah. And then I thought, you know, well, the Lord gives us a love for the truth. So yes. Those who love the truth, when you speak the truth, sometimes they may not understand it right then.
Yeah.
But if they love the truth, then they'll come to it. They're coming to Christ, and so eventually they'll get it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so sad sometimes whenever you want to talk to people that are believers about the Lord, and there's only a few things you can say.
Yeah, well, we can resort to like Jesus. Jesus then would speak to them in parables.
Yeah, that's right.
He wouldn't tell them what they meant.
Mm-hmm.
Just speak to them in parables.
Yeah.
Hit it to them. So that's something you could speak a parable to them. People who do not deliberately come to Jesus seeking for him and preferring him should not expect for him to feed them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. However much he loves the world, He'll not spend much time with the disinterested. You know the record. The record's in the scripture, how he reacted to people that were not interested. People who didn't want to hear what he had to say didn't hear very much from him. Not at all. And it wasn't because he was thoughtless. If anyone cared for people, it was Jesus. The care of Jesus isn't the point. The care of the people, that's the point. Yeah. Where people want Jesus, Jesus will never leave them barren and alone.
And the implications of this is that
would the people even be able to catch on to the teaching of Jesus? See, unless their heart is inclined towards him, they wouldn't even be able to perceive the direction that he's leading them.
No, and he won't teach them. He will not give revelation to people who don't want it.
Yes, amen.
Yep. Period.
Yep.
You've got enough examples. No one should have to make an effort to buttress this.
That's right.
It's every place in Scripture.
Yes.
And sometimes he'd speak deliberately so they couldn't understand.
Yeah. Yeah.
He'd hide it from them.
That's right.
Not to those that want. See, my point here is he feeds those who come to him.
Amen.
All right? Yeah. Now look at for another viewpoint. He feeds those who listen to him. When Jesus spoke to these people about the kingdom of God, it says the common people heard him gladly. They were glad to hear what he had to say. He didn't perform a stupendous wonder before them. He taught them.
Yeah.
The common people heard him gladly. The non-professional people. Jesus said of other sheep, speaking of Gentiles, other sheep I have, they will hear my voice. John 10:16. So I see, and the point I'm making here is Jesus speaks to those who listen.
Yes. Uh-huh.
They will hear my voice. In fact, he said, my sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. That's one of the ways. If you're this kind of person, you're part of his flock. Yes.
You know, one place Jesus said, you don't have any love for God.
That's right.
If you love God, you'd love me because I came from
him. That's right. Yes. Amen.
There was an essential part that he could pick up on that they didn't love God.
See,
they didn't have a desire for God.
This simplifies things for us because perhaps at some time I've experienced this myself. You've wrestled with how can I reach these people? Oh. And it's in a sense, it's sort of frustrating. How can I reach these? Finally, I had to ask, well, do these people want to be reached? Maybe I shouldn't be talking to them about God. Maybe I should be talking to God about them.
Yeah.
Right?
Amen. Yeah, amen.
If you got people like this, don't try and talk them into being interested.
Yeah.
Take the matter up with the king.
Amen.
So he feeds those that listen to him. And his teaching would distinguish people. But his miracles didn't, unless you're talking about the scribes and Pharisees. His miracles didn't divide the people, but his teaching did. So he feeds those that listen to him, and he feeds those who stay with him. The people before him have remained with him till the day wore on, and the scripture says that the disciples said, this is a desert place, and the time's now past. They've been there all this time.
Yeah.
Time is now past. Send the multitude away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves victuals. Mark says, when the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, this is a desert place. Time's now past. See, these people stayed with him.
Yeah.
Jesus teaches those that stay with him.
Yeah. Amen.
That don't leave him. The people had chosen to follow Jesus wherever he was. They followed him. They stayed with him. They even evidently forgot about eating. It meant that much to them. They knew no normal sustenance. They weren't thinking about normal. They knew that what he's given us, we're not going to get anyplace else. The scribes aren't going to give this to us. We're not going to get this in the synagogue on a regular meeting. Yes.
You can see that when it says he taught as one having authority and not as scribes, which you could take him that. He was giving them something they scribes
right.
couldn't give them.
That's right.
See, and Jesus doesn't overlook people like this.
Amen.
Now, this isn't the way it is in the churches. Some of you know it is like firsthand. There's people that will upbraid you because you want more. They'll actually get on your case about it.
That's right.
So you ought to be thinking about the lost.
Yeah.
You just need to shout back at you. You need to be thinking about the sheep.
Yeah.
That's who's feds the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
People in this case have stayed with Jesus. Jesus would not send them away hungry. Eventually, he'll send them away.
Yeah.
But not hungry.
Amen.
And he feeds those that are hungry.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus taught in the synagogues, he was speaking to people who in some sense were hungry.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. The psalmist said, he satisfieth the longing soul and filleth the hungry with goodness. See?
Yes.
Who does Jesus feed? These are who he feeds.
Mm-hmm.
Those that come to him, those that listen to him, those that stay with him, those who are hungry.
Yes, amen.
They want the kind of things he's serving up.
Amen.
And if God's working with you, see, there's a preliminary work done in the heart of comers.
Yes.
Jesus called it the Father drawing them.
Uh-huh.
The Holy Spirit's working,
yes.
working with them. But there's a work done in the heart of people. Hearts of people that come to Christ that create this hunger.
Amen.
It's a voracious appetite that can't be solved by anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Satan knows this. That's why he tries to lure people to other things, because he knows as long as these people have this appetite, I'm not going to be able to get through to them. So I've got to try and tempt them to want something else.
That's
See,
right.
that's what temptation's all about. That's what it's about. Those who are satisfied with fulfilling the lust of the flesh that war against the soul, they will not experience a hunger for righteousness.
That's right.
And when you talk about it to them, they will not know what you're talking about. You probably have talked to people and you've sensed they don't know what I'm talking about. A hunger and a thirst for righteousness. So there's some people, church people, I'm talking about church people now, that just simply don't know what you're talking about. But those who do hunger and thirst, they do know what you're talking about. They may not understand all about it, but it rings.
Yeah, that's right.
It rings in their remembrance. This is something I think I'm experiencing this.
That's right.
I have this appetite for something from God.
Amen.
And God won't overlook it.
Amen.
He feeds those. There are other people to whom the Lord calls out.
That's right.
Ho! Everyone that thirsteth, he calls out to the multitudes out there, but there's certain people scattered out there among all this multitude. There's certain people. This resonates. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money, without price. Good news.
Yes, amen.
Jesus stood in the temple on the day of the feast, and he shouted this out.
Uh-huh.
If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink.
Yes.
He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Yes.
Then John adds an editorial remark, this spake he, the Holy Spirit would be given to those that believe, for he was not yet given because Christ is not yet glorified.
Amen.
So Jesus is calling out.
Yes.
He's still calling out from heaven.
Amen.
Ho!
Yeah.
Everyone that thirsts, you've got this dry stuff you've been given. It's like the dust of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
You choke on it. It doesn't help you.
Mm-hmm.
You come to me.
Yeah.
What Jesus gives you, you won't choke on it.
Yes.
You won't get sick on
That's
it.
Right.
It won't upset your equilibrium or make you think crooked.
Yes.
Not what Jesus gives you.
Amen.
And Jesus feeds those that come to him. Jesus feeds those that listen to him.
Uh-huh.
Jesus feeds those who are hungry.
Uh-huh.
and stay with him. Good to know.
Amen. Yeah, Brother Gibbons, this here says that my people shall be willing in the day of my power. Now, this God can make people hungry.
Oh, yes, he can.
So, I mean, you know, if you're preaching the gospel and you meet a group of hungry people, this will energize your spirit.
Oh, yes, amen. So Jesus gets ready to feed the people that came to him and stayed with him. And were hungry. He broke the bread. First he gave thanks for it. And he broke it. He distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. So we're reading that Jesus supplied like an abundance.
Yes.
This was not a skimpy meal. It was not a lunchbox meal. The salvation is likened unto a feast. Isaiah put it this way. In this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, wines on the lees well refined. Really good food.
Amen.
All the impurities refined out of it, distilled down to this, just solid nourishment.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Again, he prophesied, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye and buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money, without price. Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not?" So you've been a good supporter, you know, of the institution and so forth. But you're not being fed.
Yeah.
All right, now Jesus has a question. You got to answer him. You don't have to answer me.
Yeah.
How come you're spending your money for something that doesn't satisfy? What are you doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
I had to answer that question myself. I had to answer that question myself. No one else can answer it for you, but he will. He'll ask you.
Yeah.
You say, you know, I'm not getting very much. He said, why are you going there?
Yeah, yeah.
What are you doing going there?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're getting something, that's another matter.
Yeah.
We're not talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
When men do not see this, that salvation is a feast, they settle for little, minuscule, incidental things, most of which apply to this life. When men do not see this, they seek their needs elsewhere, their perceived needs elsewhere. And now that's taken very seriously in heaven. When God supplies what men need, and they think they need something else, and they go somewhere else, hey, God does not look favorably on that kind of situation. So when we talk about food here, and we're talking about staples, there's food staples for the flesh, and there are staple food for the new man, too.
Yes.
By definition, a staple is a commodity for which the demand is constant. It's not like a seasonal food. Something having widespread and constant use or appeal. The sustaining or principal element. It's the food that actually supplies the nutrients that enable life to advance and grow. These are what Isaiah called fat things. Fat things full of marrow. See, that's what he's talking about. These nourishing staple foods and bread, staple foods. Paul referred to this kind of food. This is the kind of food he was talking, staple food, the foundational food, the foods you have to live, foods you have to be sustained.
Uh-huh.
There's some foods that are taste good and everything, but you don't really need them. You don't need them. They don't sustain life.
Right.
You can't go out and live on lollipops. I mean, you can't.
Yeah.
They're not a staple food. So Jesus referred to staple food when he said to Peter, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. He was talking about just give them something to eat. You know. That wasn't it. It was staple food, sustained food. This is the kind of food Paul referred to when he said to the elders at Ephesus, feed the church of God. He's not talking about marriage tips and neighborhood tips and how to get jobs. And that's not staple food. That's fluff and stuff.
That's right. Yeah.
Staple food. Peter talked about staple food when he said, feed the flock of God which is among you. Hebrews calls it strong meat. See? Now you try and live on baby food, you can try it. It'll upset your digestive system. You will not be able to live on baby food. You can't do it. It may fill you up, but you will have some real problems.
Yeah.
Digestive problems.
Yes.
You will have, but see, there are still people, there are people in Christ that are trying to live on baby food.
That's right.
And that's kind of complimentary.
Uh-huh.
That's a transgression of immense magnitude to set novel and unnourishing meals before the saints of God. This is more serious than people think. Jesus has issued a mandate, you feed my sheep.
Uh-huh.
Don't let my sheep starve right under your nose. Don't let them go away malnourished. Feed them the staple, the things they need. Feed them these things. They need them to run and to fight and to continue to obtain the prize. See, just as staple food like bread and fish could give the people energy to get back home.
Yes, that's right.
Staple food give you energy to finish the course with joy.
To be strong, to be able to withstand in the day of trial. See, this is, we're not just eating to be warm and filled, just to have something in us. But I don't know that this is the concern of a lot of people.
It's like
if you want to attract a lot of young people, you open a candy store or whatever, you know, because you know they're going to be interested in it. But see, this is not the best thing.
No.
I mean, and actually, we don't dictate what is being fed. We give what Christ has.
That's right.
And that it will make people strong.
That's right.
But when we come up with our own plan and our own diet, that may very, I'm not saying we're not involved in it, but Jesus is the one that feeds the sheep.
He does it through his people.
That's right.
It's not a direct feeding.
That's right. Wasn't here either.
Yeah, that's exactly right. The disciples distributed it. The great shepherd provides for his people nourishment. And this is, I desire to be a bit more proficient in getting this across to people, because I know that the vast majority of Christians, both here and abroad, just haven't got this yet. I see this in dealing with foreign people. They don't see this. It may be some of the leaders, but they don't see it. Hardly any of the people in foreign congregations, hardly any of the people are fed. It's unbelievable. This is the way it is. Not to mention our own country. So Jesus feeds those that come to him, he feeds those that listen to him, he feeds those that stay with him, he feeds those that are hungry, and he feeds them staple food that has spiritual substance to it, which means you're going to have to think about it, you're going to have to muse upon it, you've got to meditate upon it, see, you're going to have to cogitate about it. That's where you get the nutrients, just like a cow chewing the cud, ruminate. Cow has multiple stomachs. He eats it, sends it down to stomach number one, brings it up from that stomach, ruminates or chews the cud on it, sends it down to stomach number two. brings it up from stomach number two and goes through the same process. Yes, Jim.
I was sitting here trying to think of what the staples would be. You know, we've got the four basic food groups that sustain life, and the first one that came to my mind was promises.
Hmm.
And I remember a sermon that Brother Aaron preached. He said, faith needs a promise.
That's right.
And if the promises aren't being given, then it's not possible for faith to grow, because it only grows when a promise is
that's
given.
Right.
You have the opportunity
right.
to believe it or not.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it's good for us to think what these staples would be and make sure that we can give those when given the opportunity.
Yeah. In summary, the staple is the gospel, which contains all of these other. That's the cupboard. The gospel's like the cupboard you draw from. And you're right. You have to hold out something that God has promised.
That's right.
So he ministers staple food, not novel food. Mm-hmm. Not things that bring momentary satisfaction. That's, and he does it through his disciples. He distributed it to his disciples. And then they distributed it. They're actually the ones who distributed the food that was miraculously provided. Today this is done by the gifts God has placed in the church. Principal gifts are apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. They're distributing the food. As the church matures, the feeding takes place from the head, from which all the body is. The Ephesians 4, Colossians 2:19, from the head, from which all the body by joints and bands having nourishment ministered. All right, so now Jesus provided the nourishment, gives apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. They build up, and joints and bands, those are people.
That's right.
Yep. Members of the body. Mm-hmm. Now that it flows through them, see?
Yeah.
Jesus, to these principal gifts, to the joints and bands, then the whole body receives ministry. Ephesians 4:15 puts it this way, speaking the truth in love may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body into the edifying of itself in love. So Jesus superintends this whole operation.
Yes, amen.
First, it comes through these principal teachers that he set first in the church.
Right.
Then they build up the saints, and it begins to flow through every joints and bands and every member. Then the whole body begins to...
Yes.
It's getting ready to dwell forever with the Lord.
Yes.
That's what this is all about.
Amen.
Getting ready to dwell forever with the Lord. God is feeding us, so we'll hit the ground running on the other side.
Yes.
See?
Yes.
Everybody can see that, can't you?
Amen. So, whatever we're teaching,
to some extent, it's got to find its root or genesis in what the apostles taught, and what they taught is what Jesus
that's
gave
exactly
them to teach.
It.
So this is out of line to major on something that they never spoke
that's right.
of,
or that they didn't major.
That's right. Yeah.
If the apostles didn't major on marriage, you can't.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. Amen.
You may have a ministry, may have a TV ministry and be raking in the big bucks. But if that's not what they emphasize, that's not what you are to emphasize.
Amen. Amen.
They didn't emphasize youth, you can't emphasize youth.
That's right.
They didn't emphasize men, you don't emphasize men or women or some other group. They were faith. The apostles were faithful to deliver what Jesus gave them.
Yes, amen.
And do you know that the apostles' doctrine is the one element that the modern church is almost totally ignorant of?
Yeah.
Very few people called Christians know very much about the apostles' doctrine.
Yeah.
What did they actually teach? A lot of church members know more about what Solomon said than what Jesus and the apostles said. They do now.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we should not be satisfied with that kind of situation. So through his disciples, and how much does he distribute? The only boundary is your want.
Yeah.
As much as they want.
Yes.
Amen.
He set before them likewise of the fishes as much as they would, as much as they wanted. So Jesus will give you as much as you want.
Mm-hmm.
If you're willing to settle for a little, that's exactly what you'll get.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't subsist on a little.
Yeah.
You got an adversary that he loves people that settle for a little.
Mm-hmm.
He'll capitalize on them as much as they want. Isaiah 51 says, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth." Thirst is a want. It's a compelling, it can't be quenched. Thirst is something that a person wants. It can't be quenched except for what it's thirsting for. Now, there are some churches I cannot regularly attend. I'm not condemning them. I'm just saying I can't go there. Why? Because my appetite shrinks when I go there. I'm never satisfied. I come out wanting to recite the alphabet, you know. I want to say 2 + 2 = 4, you know. It's the kind of stuff that is so evident, it's a miracle someone doesn't see it. But see, this doesn't satisfy the soul. These places don't serve good meals. They don't. And the sheep are not well fed there. I wish I didn't have to speak in this manner. I really do. I don't get any enjoyment out of having to say something like this. Some will think I'm not loving and considerate. But listen, let me tell you something. The ones who are not loving and considerate are the ones that are not feeding the sheep.
Right.
They're the ones that ought to be charged with this.
Amen.
Not the people that are hungry.
Mm-hmm.
The people that are hungry and want to be fed. Don't be criticizing them because they want more food. Be criticizing the people that are setting a sparse table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're the ones that don't love.
That's right.
Blessed are those that hunger and thirst for righteousness. Jesus didn't say, for they'll just keep on going, keep on hungering and thirst, they'll be filled. They'll be filled. Someone says, well, but you should just study at home. But the sheep should learn to feed themselves. Well, that sounds smart, but it isn't. See, it's really stupid, but it sounds smart. Because God sets you in a body.
Amen. Yes.
This is where God puts you.
Yeah.
He puts you where you weren't the only one.
Mm-hmm.
He knew you can't unless you're isolated like John the Isle of Patmos or Paul in prison. That's a different situation.
Yeah.
But in normal circumstances, God's not going to put you where you just have to depend on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
He puts you in a body.
Amen.
Where you can be fed and nourished. Spiritual life is intended to be abundant. And therefore the means through which it's accomplished is an abundant means. See, God gives an abundance because it's targeting abundant life. It might have life and have it more abundantly. Well, you can't have more abundant life with meager supplies. I mean, this just doesn't work. That's why we read of such things as the riches of his goodness. The riches of his grace, the riches of his glory, the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. These are an abundance.
Mm-hmm.
These are the treasures from which the people are fed.
Yeah.
And they suit them for glory. They suit them for divine fellowship.
Yeah.
They make them equal to temptation. They make them able to resist the devil. They make them able to finish the course. See, it's that kind of food. There's abundant provision. Whether you're a seasoned apostle like Paul and John, you got to eat. Or you're a beginner like Timothy, you got to eat. See? Everybody's got to eat. I know that I don't think I would have said that some of the disciples don't need to be fed. I don't think I would have said that, but subconsciously I did kind of think that. They've arrived, you know.
Yeah.
No, none of us that are in this world have arrived.
Amen.
We're still en route.
That's right.
As long as you're en route, you got to eat.
Amen.
Now, when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain," and so forth. When they were filled.
Yeah.
It was a state of your filled. Matthew and Luke write, "They did eat and were all filled." Mark writes, "They did eat and were all filled." Men ate, they were filled. Women ate, they were filled. Children ate, they were filled. Old men ate, they were filled. Young men ate, they were filled. This indicates they enjoyed what they were eating.
Yes, amen.
See?
Yeah.
You can get full of, you know, tasteless things, but that's not what the Lord saves and serves up. It's delicious. It's spiritually
amen.
Delicious. Good for the palate.
Yeah.
This is a spiritual bread and nourishment. It's delightful to eat.
Amen.
I'm my happiest when I'm nourished by the things of God. You have experienced this. You've experienced this. Some of you have testified to it. I've heard you. This is the way it works. That when you're nourished and you're built up, it gladdens the heart. Your spirits are lifted up. Your anchor is more firmly cast.
Yeah, I'll never forget, Brother Fred. We were after
agape meal. We were all sitting there. We were all filled.
Yeah.
And he said he gave thanks that God made eating a delight.
Yeah, amen.
He said, because it mirrors what you're talking about right now. Mm. You've actually experienced this in the flesh, a good big meal and you're full.
Yeah.
And it's a delightful experience, and so it is in the spirit.
Yeah. You can imagine, what if the predominant color in nature was black?
Yeah.
Boy, we'd all be, oh, woe is me, you'd be dragging around. What if food all tasted bitter?
Oh.
God has made eating a delight. He's made He's made the world so it's a delight if you see it right. Well, Brother Justin, yeah.
I went to a church this one time that told me that very thing. Go home and feed yourself. They told me that. But they would have large gatherings where they would have like a hot dog community hot dog picnic, and they would invite everyone from the community, and they would all come together, and they would all eat all of this food together.
Yeah, together.
Yeah.
Mm. They were all filled.
Yes.
That's the objective. Get filled. See, the people of God work best on a full stomach. I remember when I was young, I would eat, you know, Post Toasties, Cheerios, stuff like that. My dad, he'd eat bacon and eggs and fried potatoes and, you know, stuff like that. So I asked him one time, I was young, I said, "How come you eat like that?" He said, "Well," he says, "you can't go out and do morning work on Post Toasties."
Yeah.
Well, I didn't know what he meant for a long time, but I know what he means now.
Yeah.
You can't eat a skimpy meal and then go out and do hefty kingdom work. Some of which is like resisting a fierce adversary.
That's
dogging you every minute, see? Got to be strong.
Amen.
So Jesus says,
I was thinking about this, that in the world we have all these different kinds of food. Some of it's sour, some of it's bitter. Some of the stuff we put in our mouth and we just want to spit it right back out.
Yeah.
But there's none of that kind of food in the kingdom.
Yeah.
All of it is satisfying.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's not the way law is.
Yeah, that's right.
If you try to live by law, it'll be bitter, you know.
Yeah.
Gather up the fragments. So Jesus, he didn't create a stack of unused bread.
Uh-huh.
Remember?
Yeah.
Broke all that bread. He didn't like to have a big stack of unused bread.
Uh-huh.
He made enough bread so everybody, he made just the right amount.
Yes, amen.
So everybody could eat. He provided what is needful, only fragments. That is, they'd started eating on it and they couldn't finish it. Only fragments. And they were genuine. The fragments were real bread and real fish. I mean, they weren't crumbs. That's not what that's not what the fragments were. If we serve up spiritual meals, and there's some with robust appetites that are not filled, we haven't done well. Everyone who eats from the same table, from the same supply, everyone is to be filled, whether they are beginner or whether they're a seasoned saint. Gather up the fragments that remain. This was done so nothing be lost.
That's right.
Nothing be lost. Food, whether it's for the body or the soul, is to be considered valuable. It's not for the garbage.
That's right.
Some people don't know this. You want to teach your children this. Don't throw away food.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't. Why do you?
Yeah.
Just tell them.
Yeah.
Tell them. Say, Jesus didn't throw away food. What are you doing throwing it away?
Uh-huh.
And then let them think the thing out.
Yeah.
See, he didn't send the disciples out with trash bags
yeah.
to gather up garbage. They gathered up the fragments. Now, when we've been served spiritual food as it's intended to be served, you'll sense that more was given than you got.
Uh-huh. Yes.
You ate of everything, but you left something too.
Uh-huh.
You'll sense this. Now, Jesus knew this. He told the disciples on the night of his betrayal, he told them a lot of marvelous things.
Uh-huh.
His longest discourse was that night.
Uh-huh.
He said, now the Holy Spirit, when he's come, he'll bring to your remembrance what I've said. He'll gather up the fragments. That's what he's going to do.
Yep.
He'll bring to your remembrance what I said.
Uh-huh.
You're not able to digest it here tonight.
Yeah.
They were confused about Judas. They were confused about Jesus going away. But
yeah.
when the Spirit came and
yes.
gathered up these fragments,
yes.
then they knew.
Yeah, is that same with the flesh? Yeah.
Sister Nita's made a delightful meal, and I've eaten it, and yet I've tasted it now.
Yeah, you tasted it.
I've tasted it, so I've got a certain anticipation now for those fragments later.
Yeah, fragments later. And he says, now they gathered up 12 baskets. Now, if you would compare those 12 baskets with the original meal, it's quite a...
Yeah.
Quite a contrast. But if you compare it with how many were fed, it wasn't very much.
Yeah.
The Lord Jesus knew exactly what to provide.
Yes, amen.
There wasn't a bushel load of stuff left. I don't know how you might estimate the amount of food eaten. Let's just take the lad's lunch as kind of a standard. It was a child's lunch, so it wasn't a man's. It was a child. But let's just take that as a standard for how much food was generated. If you just count the men, right? That'd be 25,000 loaves and 10,000 small women, small fish. That's the amount of food we're talking about.
Yeah.
How does 12 baskets compare with that? And if you count women and children, you estimate the crowd to say about 20,000. That means you'd have 100,000 loaves and 40,000 small fish. See, how does 12 baskets compare with?
Wow.
What I'm showing you is what was left was nothing to compare with what was consumed.
Yeah.
You always want to consume more than what's left.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
You don't want to leave where there's been an abundance of food set out. You nibbled at the meal and you left a great mess. You didn't eat. No, eat. Eat till you're filled. Do it. And remained over and above. And as these pieces weren't the original pieces, they were pieces that some of them had been eaten. Mm-hmm. See? Over and above what they had eaten. They couldn't consume the whole piece. These were actual pieces of bread and fish. They weren't whole pieces like they were distributed, but they were pieces of bread and fish that the eaters couldn't consume because they were so full. Have you ever been that full? You just I'm talking about spiritually full. You just can hardly take any more. Whatever's left, you want to make sure you make provision to keep that so you can go back to it. Now then, of course, we might ask the question, what was done with these 12 baskets, you know? Some conjecture that each disciple might have received one. I don't really think that was the case, but because later they forgot to bring bread, so they didn't. I don't think that was it. My personal opinion is the boy probably received them and then explained when he got home what happened. And they knew what he started out with. They could recognize, yeah, these are fragments of what we supplied, you know. You want to be able to bring what you didn't consume. You want to be able to bring it to God, and he says, yeah, that's some of what I distributed. Sometimes what you have left isn't what was originally distributed. So, but Jesus plainly said that nothing be lost. Don't let anything.
Yeah.
It's well to mention again that when we have a season of comments, you know, afterward and responses to preach and teach, and that's what we're doing. We're gathering up the fragments. That's what we're doing. And sometimes you take home more than you would have if you didn't have those sessions.
That's right. Amen.
So you take home some more to muse upon. You'll soon sense that when you gather with the saints and when Jesus is really there and Jesus is really teaching, you come to expect a lot. You come to be disappointed when there's not a lot. And when you leave, you want to take what you didn't discern while you were there and take it home with you. And think and muse upon it. Those are some additional thoughts I had on that passage. But I'll have to quit there. Any of you have a word that you'd like to add?
I want to, first of all, give thanks to the Lord for giving us this special episode. This, you know, earlier when I realized you were going to go over the same text, I knew that this was the Lord. That he's given us something. This is not at all the same lesson.
I know.
This is not at all, and yet it is. It's an
same
addendum
text.
That is very necessary. As we went through page two, this is exactly what I needed tonight. I needed this clarified to me, and I'm very thankful that God led you to do that. And a lot of the brothers, or a lot of people I know would have said, well, you know, we'll just do something else tonight. But you are faithful to do what God gave you, and I am very thankful for that, Brother Gibbons.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, yeah, Sister Rachel.
Christ feeds and not come by faith, but men try to come to eat, then Christ will turn them away.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Yes, Brother Judah.
I appreciated this lesson because it was an illustration of what you were expounding about taking up the fragments. Like Brother Bob said, you covered this text once already, and it wasn't the same as when we covered it the last time. So it perfectly illustrates what the text is all about.
Yes,
that's right. We gather them up. That's right.
Gathering up the fragments.
Amen.
But also, this point that you brought out is the limit is your want.
Yeah.
That is very, very liberating.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no, this is what you get, and even if you want more, you can't have any more.
Yeah.
It would be really nice if I could go to a nice restaurant, order a steak, and when I'm finished, the waitress comes out and says, do you want another one? And I would get another one if I wanted another one. But that's not the way it works.
No.
Well, the kingdom of God, if you want more,
you get more.
You can have more.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
It's a concept that's completely foreign to the world. Uh-huh. If you want it, you can have it. Because that's not the way everything is. I mean, that's economics 101. If you want it, you can have it. That's like, no, that's not true. But that's not the way God does things.
Yeah.
The new nature that we've been given, that one that's born of God that doesn't sin,
yeah,
it wants what God gives.
Yes, amen.
And when you truly want what God gives, you think God is going to deny his own creation?
No. Uh-uh.
So the fact that the limit is your want is a silent exhortation.
Yeah.
Because it's freely given, you can have as much as you can possibly hold. Because when you get that much, your capacity will be enlarged.
That's right.
So then you'll want even more, and you can get it. And
amen.
So the cycle continues.
Yeah.
Now I'll interpret some things that have happened here in our assembly. And we've got a number of different people, men and women, that are capable of feeding the flock. When you step back and look at it right, is because we have stronger appetites. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So he's made this way to provide more.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
To provide more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A great provision.
Amen.
Yes, brother.
I just praise the Lord for having an appetite.
Yeah.
And if you don't have an appetite, you're sick.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yes, Sister Maddie.
This matter of there being different tastes in food.
Mm.
If you just ate something that was bitter, it would not be appealing to you. But
mm-hmm.
someone who is skilled at preparing food
mm.
knows how to mix
things
together so that they're appetizing.
Yes.
Whenever you work frequently with the scriptures, and you're
mm-hmm.
familiar with it, you'll know how to prepare so that you're using a balance.
Mm-hmm.
There's a balance to what you're presenting to the brethren,
mm-hmm.
so that you're not giving overly bitter or overly
mm-hmm.
salty meals.
Mm-hmm.
You're giving something that is going to be appetizing and nourishing
mm-hmm.
and pleasing all
yes.
in one meal.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Sarah?
When you were talking about that we need to be fed and everything, I said that sheep need to be fed. If they are not fed, they will starve and die.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Brother Aaron?